Hello, my name is Jonathan Wickman. I'm head of social media in Maersk Line, the giant container shipping company, you might know it. I'm going to explain very briefly in this session today what we've been doing in social media for the past 1.5 years. Phase one, just to backtrack a bit, and you know, where are we right now and what have we been doing so far? I think that the story is very briefly that we've been doing it from the inside, and that's where we are different from a lot of other big companies, where they might, you know, go out and make a decision, perhaps from the marketing department, to go on social media because it makes sense and it's the trending thing and everything. What will usually happen is that you assign a person there and they will hire an agency, and they'll come up with a big plan, and management will get involved, and they'll say, you know, what's the business value, and they'll set up some very specific business goals, even short term, that they need to reach. And I think companies even a tenth our size, will then have the approach where management will be involved right from the beginning, when the very first Facebook post, for instance, comes out, and then they'll sit there, wonder, you know, the caption for the post will probably have been through legal department, and then they'll wonder, why are people not liking us? Maybe we are not social after all. So that's sort of the classical scenario, and what they decided in Maersk Line was that they had to insource the skill. So that's where I sort of enter the picture. And I think that was a very wise choice, because it makes it cost efficient. You simply do it from the inside. That's one thing, and the other thing, and equally important, is that it becomes credible. So, to be a bit more specific, then we are today live on 12 platforms. We have a clearly defined channel strategy. We use all the different channels for various purposes, but the overarching trend is sort of, you can tell, I would claim that the trend or the tendency to treat social media as communication, not as a marketing exercise. Again, the credibility thing. We have 750,000 fans on Facebook. Our engagement rate is consistently between 5% and 10%. That's probably what I'm the most proud of here. On Twitter, we have 35,000 followers. What I'm the most proud of here is that our average pool, meaning how influential are those people we are connected to, our average pool is around 15 times higher the average pool, meaning, and again, pool means influential, how influential are you in your networks on Twitter. So we had a small analysis done on that. LinkedIn, we have 27,000 followers. We're using that for the more serious part of our presence, presenting all our products and services and interacting with people in groups and forums, really trying to get something, some high quality input from the communities. And finally, Instagram, as the softest piece of the puzzle, we have 22,000 followers. What we've also realized, and that was all the numbers, and I think that's fine and well, and of course it happened really quickly, and it's been sort of the ketchup effect, I would say, if I'm to describe how we achieved all these numbers. But I think we learned also the first 1.5 years that there's more to social media than social media, that deep down it's more interesting, not because of all the numbers and people you're engaged with, but because it's a new way of thinking and acting actually as a business as well. That a good example here is the rise of corporate journalism, that companies are seeing more and more that instead of pushing marketing messages out, it's better just to try and be honest and trustworthy in what they do, because that'll give them influence. That'll make people believe in the news they publish are true, And they better be as well. So it's not just a matter of believing, it's actually becoming a publisher in your own right as a company. It takes a lot of honesty to achieve that position. But we've actually seen it already. A couple of months ago, we had a piece of news coming out in the shipping industry that we were Maersk Line, now the most influential, had the most influential online presence in the entire industry, including all the media outlets. So for the company, that was both quite surprising because we surprised Journal of Commerce and Lloyd's List and all that, but also really good news and something we maybe didn't even expect from the beginning. So again, you know, it probably sounds pretty good in itself, but last summer I sort of challenged. We'd been in this explorative phase for 9 months, but I sort of challenged the company a bit and myself, and said, you know, what is the value of this? It might turn out to be worthless. Do we drive any business from it at all? What if we remove it? What would happen? Would it fall apart, or would it? Everything just remained the same. Perhaps it would. So I said, I would like to do a study, and they said, you know, yes, let's do that. Makes sense to do something. Try to be as objective as you possibly can. So in terms of value creation, we quickly realized that we actually have a ROI or return on investment on Facebook, which according to our calculations was about 5,000%. But just to make it more realistic, we said 1,500. What that told us is that it's almost absurd to go out and calculate on these things in such a singular manner, because it is such a complex value creation we're looking at these days, as I mentioned earlier. And what one a B2B social media expert, Jay Baer, he told us is that, you know, what you've created so far for very little money, that's, you know, we can spend a lot of time trying to measure that. But look, since you haven't spent any money, then it's astonishing, basically, the value creation itself. And those our values will be really huge. But the interesting thing is that through this bottom-up approach, you've managed to get the culture on board. And very few companies are able to do that. And the interesting thing now is not what is the value of this, but how can we build on it? And at the same time, Michael Chui, or Chui from McKinsey, he told us that, you know, frankly speaking, it will be detrimental for companies not to adapt to social technologies. Not because it's the new thing, but because it is the way the world is moving, basically. So if you don't know how to use it to optimize your business and make the most of things, then your competitors will do it, and you'll struggle in the end. So the decision there pretty early on in the study was, okay, let's look ahead and try to identify new areas. And we did that, and we actually started with the help of Michael from McKinsey, who presented or went through his study of 10 ways social technologies can add business across the enterprise. And out of those 10 different areas, we identified 4 sort of the low-hanging fruits that would be the natural next step for us. So number one is communication, and we're already doing that. So what we've done here is, I'll get back to that briefly, actually. Number two is customer service. Number three is sales. And number four is internal collaboration. That's the 4 main pillars in our strategy moving ahead. The communication part, we're already doing that. And what we're looking at here is basically continuing that effort and even trying to be more specific in our channel strategies. Proactively telling people on LinkedIn, we're doing this. On Google+, we're doing that. You can follow us on Twitter, where you'll get this and that. So have a very clear idea of who we are, even clearer idea of who we are connected to where. Our approach, again, is about being credible and trustworthy, sharing negative stories as well as positive, and it's about humanizing the company and using storytelling as the vehicle to drive attention. The new one of the first of the three new areas is customer service, and here the important thing is a 1-to-2 ratio, which says something about how efficient social customer service can be when used the right way. Because 1-to-2 is what you usually say that what it explains is that one person doing customer service via social channels can replace two persons in a call center. In the sales area or arena, our approach will not be to begin to really push a lot of marketing messages down the channels. Instead, we're trying to empower our employees, key our experts actually, to go get in early in the whole sales, the customers' buying decision process or journey, to position them as thought leaders in their field. One example could be, you're an expert on the cotton trade. Why don't you use Twitter and LinkedIn and blog about it, and we'll support you? And what you actually see is that if you use the social channels the right way and you train people to do that, then they become more trustworthy. And it's the selling part is much easier because you'll pull people towards you instead of having to knock down all the doors and in order to make that sale that you can't live without. So finally, and this is what McKinsey told us, the biggest potential for companies and why they should use social adapt to social technologies, it's the internal use of it. And here they're talking about a 20-25% productivity gain for knowledge workers, which is basically something they say, you know, we spend about 60% of our time every week in offices around the world writing emails and having meetings, and a lot of this time is simply wasted and not very efficient. So if used the right way, internal collaboration platforms can optimize knowledge workers' time in a way so you almost get one day a week, extra day a week, where you can perform other tasks. So really a lot of businesses are looking at this right now, not least after this McKinsey study came out last year. But really it's not an easy thing to achieve. And the big question is, how do we get people to collaborate in a way where it doesn't just where it really adds value instead of just take up a lot of time, and here that's something we're looking at right now. But I would say it's just on top of my head, off the top of my head, that you need a compelling purpose, you need a reason why they should collaborate, and they shouldn't collaborate about anything. They should only collaborate about things that add business value overall, and they should. You shouldn't just put the platforms out there. Then that's what you would call a provide and pray method, and research shows it has a 90% failure rate. So you shouldn't either. Even worse is the provide and pressure method. So you need to find somewhere in between, where you don't necessarily make a lot of rules, but you try to motivate and inspire and get the right behavior in there. I think what social media is teaching a business like ours is that in order to really make the most of it and unlock the full potential, we need to embark on a cultural journey. We need to move from the me to we mentality or mindset, and we need to instill a culture where people are not concerned about, you know, how much they earn necessarily or what their job grade is, but more about what the work itself contains. So it's more about getting passion in there and teamwork, and that's of course not something you do or just by like that. But I think that's what social media overall is promoting these years, that you get more status now from being good at sharing your knowledge than by protecting it and hoping for the best. So in that sense, it's a beautiful vision, I think. And that concludes it.